Okay, great. So hello, everybody. Thanks for joining us today. My name is Samantha Gambling. I'm the community animator for Farm to School, specifically for the Vancouver Regional Hub. So I help and facilitate Farm to School activities in Vancouver, Richmond, and the North Shore. For those who are new to the concept, Farm to School is a movement that's growing strong across North America. It provides an overarching framework for many kinds of programs and activities that support schools to both source healthy local food, as well as provide hands-on food systems education and increase school and community connectedness. So Farm to School BC is a provincial network that promotes, supports, and links Farm to School activity, policy, and programs across the province. Today, as part of our regional Farm to School program, I'm really happy to be hosting our second Farm to School webinar on the theme of Farm to School in the context of reconciliation. And before I introduce our panelists today, I'd like to just make a few notes about the Zoom webinar platform that we're currently using. So first and foremost, I need to tell you that this webinar is being recorded, so it's going to be uploaded to the Farm to School website for future viewing. Soon, I'm going to hand over the screen to our panelists. If you have a question or comment during the presentation at all, I encourage you to write it in the question and answer box you'll see at the bottom of your screen. You're welcome to type something in there and test it out. Our panelists have left some time for questions at the end of the presentation, so they will answer your questions then. And if anyone is experiencing any issues during the presentation at all, just send me a private message, I think in the chat box, which is also at the bottom of your screen. You can, my name on this webinar is Cecilia, so that's who you would be directing the message to, even though my name is Sam. So I will do my best to resolve them if you send me any messages. So without further ado, I'm going to introduce our panelists. We've got Spirit Lavallee, who has been a teacher in the Outreach Alternate School at Britannia Secondary in Vancouver's East Side for 6 years. She is Cree and Métis and Wet'suwet'en background. The Outreach Alternate School is a senior grade 10 to 12 school. Students graduate with their regular or adult Dogwood diploma. It's an Indigenous-focused school, with the majority student population being of First Nations heritages. The program consists of two teachers and two youth and family workers, approaching education programming and curriculum with a holistic philosophy for wraparound student support and a strong integration of Indigenous content in all courses and school experiences. Lori Snyder is a mother, storyteller, and artist. She's a Métis herbalist and educator, blending her Indigenous roots of the Soutena, Assiniboine, Cree, Ojibwe, and Nipissing nations with her Scottish, French, and Celtic ancestry. For the past 25 years, Lori has been studying and researching plant medicines and wild edibles. Combining both the First Nations perspective and European herbal traditions, Lori's vision is to create native, edible, and medicinal food forests throughout our urban landscape for all peoples to access. She also offers herbalscaping workshops and wild edible and medicinal plant walks. Ian Marcuse works as a community food developer for the Grandview Woodland Food Connection and Neighborhood Food Network. He brings to his work many years of environmental activism and community organizing, including considerable work supporting Indigenous nations' struggles for sovereignty and land protection. Ian is also a graduate of the UBC School of Community and Regional Planning, from which he brings forward a strong and inclusive community engagement practice. So, quite an impressive panel. I'm so grateful and honored to welcome them here to talk with us. Ian, Spirit, and Lori, the microphone is yours.
Awesome. Can you see us? Can you see me? There's Spirit. There's Lori.
Hello.
Okay, so hello, everybody. I must say that I'm very honored to be part of this discussion about school gardens and reconciliation with Lori and Spirit, and a big hello from Britannia High School here in East Vancouver on the unceded territory of the Coast Salish peoples. Being a part of this discussion has been a very interesting a process for me, I think, which for me very much concerns my work as a community food developer. Better understanding reconciliation is a big concern of mine, and an important step in building positive relations with community members, some of which are participants in my program. So my mandate is to program for and to support food equity, food access, all specifically for vulnerable community members, all under the lesser understood term food justice. So in my mind, connecting reconciliation with food sovereignty and food security further clarifies my understanding of what food justice can mean. That being a linking of our work to the broader anti-racist decolonization and social justice movement building. More specifically, in terms of reconciliation, this requires an understanding of the ways in which colonization has removed Indigenous communities and peoples from their land and stripped them of their hunting and fishing and gathering rights and connection to cultural foods, and supporting Indigenous people in their struggle to reclaim their land and for food sovereignty and self-determination, which is kind of a bigger goal in my mind. But let's step back and just give you a little bit of the context in which we're working within here at Britannia. First off, here in Grandview Woodlands, where Britannia is located, is home to one of the largest urban Indigenous communities in the city. So with about 9% in Grandview Woodlands as compared to about 2% in the citywide. Grandview Woodlands also has upwards of 20% of households who are food insecure. Britannia schools have the largest numbers of Indigenous students in all of the city, with about one third of the secondary students being Indigenous and two thirds of the elementary kids being of Indigenous heritage. So a lot of the children and youth that we work with in the gardens are Indigenous. Britannia also became the first community center in Vancouver to amend its constitution to reflect a focus on reconciliation. So this institutional acknowledgement kind of requires of staff and others like myself who work at the community center to think about how we program for the community around reconciliation. And from my perspective, Indigenous food security in our community is certainly one of the most important directions in our work. So school gardening, as we know, it's a very tangible way for students to learn about and connect with the land. And I would also argue that food gardens open up an opportunity to have a discussion about what reconciliation can mean. More specifically, what people like Don Morrison, the director of the Working Group on Indigenous Food Sovereignty with the BC Food Systems Network, has described as a, quote, re-indigenization of the land and food systems. So our school gardens here at Britannia are providing us an amazing space to learn about traditional knowledge of plants and habitats, including Indigenous foods, medicines, and materials, as well as language and vocabulary around plants and the environment. We can also learn about the roles of plants and animals in narratives, in ceremony, and belief systems. So when we're in the garden, I like to tell the students that where we're standing, the slopes of Grandview Woodland, which rise up from False Creek to the west and Burrard Inlet to the north, were once the principal blueberry gathering grounds for all of the villages in the area. And so as the settlers moved in, of course, the Indigenous peoples were displaced and given tickets on the train to pick blueberries out in the Chilliwack area. We have a very important history here in our community that nobody knows about. So this story, you know, teaches the students about Indigenous history, about the impacts of colonization, in acquiring a more authentic sense of place for the students. It acknowledges the importance of traditional foods and offers the possibility or vision of introducing native blueberries in this area as part of reconciliation. If you ask youth, particularly Indigenous youth, about their connection to the land, for example, berry picking, a lot of them will eagerly talk about the berry picking that they did last summer or when they were young with their families. So it's a good in to get the kids interested in the garden, and it also valorizes their culture and traditional food practices. So at Britannia, we've got several large garden areas, and we work with six classes. We work with two alternative classes, outreach, as Spirit mentioned. We also work with the biology 11 class, home ec 8, the grade 3s and 4s. And we've prioritized, we at the Grandview Woodland Food Connection have prioritized school gardening in order to affect healthy food understanding at an earlier age, as well as obviously to help grow some food for the cafeteria and classroom teaching. Ideally, as a next step in our work, you know, as the plants mature, we'll be able to incorporate more of the foods that we're growing into classroom food preparation and eating. So I'm going to switch over here to show you some slides now to give you some, to show you a little bit about our gardens here. So hopefully you can all see this now. Okay, so one of the first things we did after building out the main garden was to have a, can you all see this, the slides? Yeah, so one of the first things we did after building out our first gardens was to have a garden blessing and witness ceremony, then later a naming. So it was very important that we acknowledge and respect that we're on Coast Salish land, and to invite this ceremony in as part of the students' learning about Indigenous culture. So we brought in an Indigenous elder and cultural educator to help teach the youth and lead them through the ceremony. And it was a fantastic opportunity for the youth, both Indigenous and non-Indigenous youth, to better understand the significance of the garden and the land in within a spiritual, a social, and a cultural framework that included understanding of one's responsibility to take care of the land, which is a core value in many Indigenous worldviews. I shift it over to the next slide. So here we see a group of youth that are part of this this naming ceremony. It took, or this garden blessing, which was a ceremony that took about 2 hours to work through, and included a witnessing by other members in the community and other students. So it was a tremendous learning experience for the kids, and of which they were obviously very proud to be a part of. The garden naming was a further opportunity to talk about local Indigenous history and colonization as it's impacted language. The students were fascinated by what language can teach us about culture, beliefs, values, and so on. Coast Salish, or more specifically the Halkomelem language, expresses ways of being in relation to the land and others in anomalous ways to, say, Western ideas of land and land ownership, for example. The name Nukhais-Wuthainuk, or transformed life that the students eventually chose, expressed, is a powerful Halkomelem word which expressed the students' understanding of the transformation of the space from a previously somewhat unused space to this flourishing garden. And the kids were really keen to have, you see this backwards seven in the name, which is a glottal stop in the Coast Salish language. So the kids really wanted to have this seven in the name of the garden, which they thought was really cool. So transforming our gardens, of course, includes a lot of berry, planting a lot of native plants and berry bushes. And a favorite activity of mine is to bring the grade threes down to the garden to do some berry picking. Of course, they go wild over this. And so this past year, we were able to gather service berries, gooseberries, some currants, Oregon grape, lots of raspberries. And then we went back to the classroom later and made coconut ice cream, coconut milk ice cream with wild berries without any sugar. So of course this was a real big hit with the kids. So as always, we're looking for more areas to plant out the school grounds with berry bushes. Not only for obvious environmental reasons, because a lot of the berry bushes are drought resistant, but also for this re-indigenization of the school grounds. So here are some of our berry bushes that are starting to mature and do really well. Our latest project at the New Britannia Carving Pavilion is a full native food and medicinal plant garden. And we're working with Lori closely on this project, which is going to provide us a lot more learning opportunities about these plants for our student. And Spirit will also talk a little bit more about some of the learning opportunities that the garden can provide in the classroom. So all the plants are native plants, and we're planting huckleberries, salal, Oregon grape, kinnikinick, coastal strawberry, thimbleberry, salmonberry, Nootka rose, dogwood, hardhack, ferns, wild ginger, goldenrod, snowberry, ninebark, gooseberry, trailing blackberry, lingonberry, and redwood sorrel, to name most of the plants, or many of the plants that are in the garden. So it's been less than a year since we planted, and but a lot of the plants are taking hold and thriving. It's really a beautiful spot, and the pavilion was created as specifically to support the reconciliation efforts that we're doing at the community center and at Britannia School. So we have artists in residence that are working in the carving pavilion, and students are invited to work with these artists throughout the year. So finally, another popular activity that we do with the kids is to take them out to the Tuwush project out at the UBC farm, which is formerly known as the Aboriginal Community Kitchen Project, where the students are able to gain exposure to a different perspective of Indigenous food growing. Most importantly, the students learn how the Tuwush project is about supporting Indigenous people, many from the inner city and the downtown east side, to gain a healthy connection to the land, to connect them to dignified food access of culturally appropriate foods that they grew up with, as well as gaining a more positive relationship to fresh, healthy food. School gardens like the Tuwush project can provide youth an experience of growing food that many have never had, and especially for the Indigenous students, learning about traditional knowledge and especially the growing of traditional foods. So back at Britannia, new Circles of Well-Being project that I'm involved with is bringing together Indigenous, Vietnamese, Latin American, and other elders, along with youth in promoting well-being and community belonging. And as part of this project is the intentional preparation of food, of serving the food, of sharing, and having a discussion of what healthy food is and its importance to us holistically. Our goal is with all food programming on site and in the schools will be to incorporate more of the traditional foods that we're growing in these dinners, and helping connect the circle between the growing and the sharing, understanding of promoting belonging among all of us, as well as reconciliation. So hopefully this gives you a general impression of the work that we're doing here at Britannia. And at this stage, I'm gonna pass it over to Lori, who's been a fantastic partner and teacher of traditional plant knowledge, and so thank you very much. So here's Lori.
Hi, welcome everyone, and thanks for all of that, Ian. It's so totally inspiring, and knowing that there is already a pathway that's being carved out here at Britannia for us to really be able to take that on and see truly how easy it is for us to bring in more of our Indigenous foods. But, you know, one of the things that I also think about, it's not just the Indigenous foods here to the West Coast, but that we can be looking at some of these berries and other foods like the Three Sisters that are also Indigenous, you know, across the country and over in Eastern Canada. So one of the quotes that I love to share with everyone is from a book that was called Native American Herbology by Alma Hutchins. And in that book, it says, "Man esteems himself happy when that which is his food is also his medicine." So when I do my teachings, that I really like to bring in that philosophy, that idea that, you know, really thinking about if we're eating really good foods, healthy foods, foods that are Indigenous to us, and, you know, that can be any culture, then I think that's part of our pathway into our health. So I really love that quote, just to, you know, to get people really thinking about it. Yeah, what we're eating is really affecting us a lot. And, you know, recently I went to a lecture, and in this lecture named Simran Sethi, she was talking about doing radical acts. And I really appreciated that, because it's that, you know, when we start to collect our wild foods again, or we do some urban foraging, that we're actually doing a radical act. We know that our food systems are being tampered with, and we're seeing a lot of discomfort and dis-ease. So, you know, for us to reclaim that, and also eating the foods that are actually native to this specific area, there's a part of me, and I haven't found any research that actually says that we're sort of eating the DNA of this land. And I think that's part of our reclaiming. I think our power is very much in the foods that we eat. So I'm all about doing some radical acts here and getting people, you know, more comfortable in putting their hands into the soil and understanding that in that act, there are a few benefits from that, whether it's, you know, the hormones being flooded through the body and the serotonin and the dopamine being produced, or that we, you know, we're taking that fresh carrot or even a fresh dandelion root and chewing on that we're getting those microorganisms into the gut, and we're getting our probiotics and our prebiotics. So to me, those are all very important radical acts. And then when we're also eating these foods that are, you know, growing right now, like, you know, versus buying a cauliflower that was picked 2 weeks ago in California, we're actually getting a high nutritional value. And what I'm noticing for myself, the more, you know, foods from within my environment, foods from the farmer's market or urban foraged, I'm getting a high nutritional value. So we're actually eating less, and you know, it's, you know, it's resilience, right? It's that self-responsibility that sort of comes up with it. So one of the things that I, you know, I start usually with a circle with the kids, and I want to know where they're starting from. And it's amazing how few of us actually know anything about our living world, right? There's a term called nature's blindness. And so, you know, us getting more in touch with that, we get to reclaim our knowledge. We also get to recognize that we're actually part of the ecosystem. So, you know, one of the stories I share is, say, for instance, about the Gary Oak not doing very well over in the Saanich Peninsula. That's because those bulbs that grew underneath that more the calamus bulbs, when we were going in there and doing that harvesting, what we were doing is we were keeping the forest at bay. And it was when I recognized that, when it, you know, I did that research and found that story, it was that moment of the light bulb going off, going, wow, we're actually part of the ecosystem. And, you know, that's so much about what Indigenous knowledge is about. It was never about ownership. It was about stewardship. And as I, you know, dive in more and learn, say, about plant spirit medicines, is that's kind of the information that's coming through, is to remind us to be back in our rightful place of stewardship. This is why I'm so excited about working with Ian here and Spirit and the rest of the crew, is that we get to take that ownership again and see how we can, you know, be pruning those bushes and making products from it, or weaving baskets or making dream catchers, that, you know, in all of those acts, you know, collecting the leaves and replenishing the soil is that act of being part of that ecosystem. So, you know, something else is to recognize that our food is truly what defines us as people. When we go traveling and we go to other cultures and we eat other foods, we get a sense of, you know, what that's about. So it's time for us to, you know, really step forward and offer more of that, especially in this area, as it's, you know, it's native to this area. So there was something, it was about ask the questions, how can we do better, and how can we do things differently? And I think some of the things is that we can make better choices here. We can be more hopeful about our future. We can inspire others. And I think it's also about the sharing of knowledge. And, you know, it's not just Indigenous plants that are growing around us. There are other plants that have come to join us that have actually been here on Turtle Island for at least 500 to 600 years. For example, the dandelion and the plantain. So, you know, it's sharing those knowledge of the plants that are here with us, I think, is really important. I wanted to also share with you guys some, you know, some thoughts around examples and activities about, you know, the garden as it gets created, as to what we might want to do with it. And of course, you know, recognizing the seed collection. And, you know, part of the knowledge or the tradition was that when you actually went out harvesting, you would take those seeds and you would spread them somewhere else. So again, it ties back to the fact that we are part of the ecosystem, like the birds eating those seeds and leaving them somewhere else. That's part of our role here as well. I love the idea of doing propagation, so understanding more about the plants, so bringing in more of those sciences. I think getting into some high production areas, like, you know, looking at edges around the schools, boulevards, along the chain link fences, you know, that sort of just are tucked out of the way, but are still there, where we could, you know, really, instead of just making one or two jars of jam, we could make 20 or 30 jars of jam, right? So, you know, changing the culture around the schools, and really bringing in those Indigenous native plants so that we can really tie it into our curriculum. And like I said, take that ownership. So as I was walking here today, I could see the drip line off the roof area on the cemented pathway. And I kept thinking, wow, we could get maybe some cedar and carve some beautiful boxes and have those lined up so that water coming off is being collected there. And there would just be berries that anyone could have access to them. And, you know, part of our vision here is to have the kids that Spirit's going to talk more about, you know, do up some signage so people can, again, start to feel more comfortable knowing that this food is right here versus don't touch that berry, I don't know what it is, right? So, you know, us really knowing our environment. Some of the other things that I encourage the kids is always thinking about how do we learn? And one of the ways that I recognized, I wasn't, you know, great in comprehension at school. I wasn't great at reading. You know, I was better at listening and someone telling me a story or showing me something. So one of the things is I invite the kids when I take them out is to start creating their own mind maps. where, you know, you're drawing a picture of a plant. I'm going to just show that. I don't know how well. This is the red alder. Sorry, you can't kind of see me, but anyways. Oh, maybe. Up. Oh, okay. You did see that one. And here's another one where we're showing the, you know, we're drawing the plants and then we're writing words around it, right? So recognizing that there's many different ways of learning and that, you know, a big part of our learning in the First Nations was through the listening, the stories, the songs. And I want the kids to also recognize how do they do their learning. The other thing that I'm really excited about is that we can start to look at the seasons as well, that, you know, we are truly affected by the seasons. We should be eating through the seasons, and that, you know, one of the plants that we put in the garden, it was kind of funny. I said to him, we've got to put fireweed in there. And so we looked around, scouted around to find some seeds. And by the time we actually got the seeds, the fireweed had already showed up in the soil, which was really exciting for me. So it's one of the things that I recognize, it's that spiritual aspect. You know, when we ask those questions and when we invite and we start a dialogue with the world around us, it starts to respond to us. So I'm excited because this spring we'll be able to actually eat some of those spring shoots. So remembering the traditions of that, following that seasonal eating. And, you know, it's not just the salmon, the fireweed, we can also do the salmon berry, the thimbleberry, the cow parsnip, you know, so there's a variety of different plants that we can add in. And again, this is why we really want this garden to expand beyond where we've just got it, say, around the carving pavilion. This is more of a showcase, but really taking that concept and taking it all around the schoolyards. And then, of course, you've mentioned berries. I picked some berries just last week. You can see my little basket. These are the evergreen huckleberries. And I also have some calendula flowers in there that I just picked from the garden here at Britannia. And so I'm so delighted when I can still find wild plants growing around and putting things aside. I'm going to dry these berries. So when I'm here with the kids next time, in a couple weeks, I'll be able to show them these berries because we've actually just planted these particular plants. This is the evergreen huckleberry in our garden. And so we can see what it tastes like when it's dried now, because they're a little bit sour. So we'll get more of a sweetness later on. And these beautiful flowers will infuse in some oils, and then we can make some salves and lip balm. So, you know, recognizing that there's so many items within the garden, not just about food and medicines, but also tools and implements. And then, you know, come the fall, it's all about digging up the roots. So if you haven't dug up your dandelion roots yet, I highly recommend you go out there, make some apple cider vinegar tinctures, get your minerals for your hormones. You know, these are all the kinds of things that I love to share with everyone. And then in the wintertime, again, you know, the fact that the season has changed, that we do our inward. And this is, of course, when we do our singing and our songs, but it's also about planning and what crafts could we actually make, like the dream catchers. You know, it doesn't matter what age the kids are, they all love making them. You know, that teaching behind the dream catchers is so important. And of course, the more we prune, whether it's the willow or the red orse or dogwood, we're going to get a stronger plant. So again, you see by us snipping and trimming and cleaning that we're part of that ecosystem. Let's dig up the roots. Let's make some dyes. Let's do some coloring. Let's weave some baskets. Let's go and find some of those invasive, say the blackberry or the English ivy, and bring them back, let them dry, and do some really great crafting with all of that. So I feel like I could talk forever, but I want to make sure that everybody has a chance to talk. And so I'm going to pass you over to Spirit, and hopefully we'll get some questions from you guys as well, and we can share more of what we're doing here. So here's Spirit for you.
Thanks, Lori. Hello, I'm Spirit. I'm a mother and a teacher here in the Britannia community. I also live in this community, and I have been in the outreach program for 6 years, and I was in the mainstream school before that. So I've always been connected to Britannia right from the beginning of my career. So some of the things that I was hearing and some of the things I'm really excited about in working with Ian and Lori in this initiative is making connections. And that seems like a really big theme for me. I think I started making connections when my colleague, the other teacher in our program, suggested that we do this partnership. And then right away, both of us were really excited and we started working off of each other and dreaming up new ideas and learning experiences and how students can not only get credit for school and for graduation, because we are a full graduating program, and that's something we're really proud of. We actually graduate the most First Nations students in Vancouver schools for how small our population is. We are a program of less than 30 students, and usually about half of those students graduate each year. So when we were starting to dream up all of these ideas and think, how can we give them credit? We can give them credit for English, we can give them credit for Earth Science, we can give them credit for BC First Nations 12. We can give them credit for, you know, any kind of, like, I'm also doing a publishing course. So all of these things that we're only two teachers and we're trying to run a full graduating program. So we take up a lot of extra courses. And it kind of goes with this new curriculum that has been starting to be rolled out. And this is our first year of moving towards implementing that new curriculum. And it's not so much that it's new for us. In the alternate world, we've kind of already been doing a new curriculum, and that's kind of why I guess we've been alternate. So doing project-based work, doing hands-on learning experiences, being able to value how a project like working in the garden, learning about the plants, harvesting the plants, connecting with the earth, finding out how Indigenous uses of those plants were and what their relationship to the earth was, as well as family management and social emotional stuff. And then doing something with all of that and having an authentic product at the end that they could be proud of to show, because a lot of times we give students assignments and they're like, yeah, here's my assignment, and hand it in, and that nothing ever becomes of it. It's something that they've done to jump through a hoop for the teacher to show them, yeah, I kind of get what you're talking about. This has more authenticity to it, where they, Lori was talking about ownership, and I really like that she said it's not just about ownership, it's about stewardship. And that they can start to take some pride in their community, that they can bring awareness and responsibility and hold others accountable as well as themselves. And because you don't want to wreck something or disrespect something that you've put in a lot of time and work for. So with this assignment that we've done, and we've spread it out through several different courses, and so we work on it quite a few number of times a week. And we have that flexibility to do that here. In the mainstream school, it might look a little bit different, and with collaborating with other teachers, especially teachers that are really closely related in their subject areas, or where, you know, it has an ability to cross those boundaries, like with English and art, with science and social studies, those types of areas, when we're able to work on it quite a bit, we're able to make sure that those credits that they're doing, like we did a work cited, we looked at books that were talking about Indigenous uses of plants, about local Indigenous plants to this area, what kind of habitat are in this area. So we looked at those books and we learned how to do a work cited page. We looked at some websites and we learned how to do work cited on websites. So that can all be applied to English. In First Nations 12, they really talk about stewardship and all these concepts of leadership and how Indigenous communities worked in their different territories, and which plants and resources that they used, and why they wanted to ensure that it continued. And so that has almost, doing this garden project has almost covered, you know, two or three chapters in that BC First Nations curriculum. So we're able to hit a lot of academic expectations and criteria. For earth science, I'm not the science teacher, and I forgot to ask the science teacher what she would like me to add in about the science, but they're studying like the processes and you know, the organic processes in ecosystems and habitats, and you know, the assignment that we have, and we do have students who are in both science and in First Nations, and so we are able to divide up how we're going to give them credit for that, and I'll talk about that in a second. But we're giving them an opportunity to write, to research, to get their hands in the soil and make a connection with the earth, to make a connection back to their own community, to make a connection with the curriculum that they're working in that will help them graduate. And a lot of that is done through the collaboration with the community, collaboration with Lori, with Ian, with Farms to School, collaboration between the two teachers, and how we can really value what the students are learning and taking from the project. And so not only is it about making connections and collaborating, but really integrating Indigenous content into the curriculum. So as an Indigenous-focused school, we do that quite a bit. We do it with the learning experiences in certain classes. We do quite a bit of learning experiences in the community. So for instance, in the past, we've gone to learning sweats. We've also taken part in the Tuished program, learning how to cut and processed salmon, helping them put the garden to bed, helping them plant in the spring. We usually are always part of the harvest feast. This was our first year that we weren't able to partake in that, but we always find that when we go to the garden and when we are out in the community doing those types of things where they can show their leadership, that they're actually a much happier, easier group to manage. Mm-hmm. Getting out that energy. And there's something about working in soil that kind of like releases their happy hormones, I guess. And not only that, but as teachers, we start to find our inspiration again. We start to not be so bogged down because it gets so busy with our schedules and, you know, this meeting and this student and that student and all of the little things that we have to do that aren't inside the actual classroom and all of the planning activities that we have to do. So this really inspired me and Sarah to go, what can we do with this? How can we learn from this? And so we designed this assignment where they're taking one plant from our garden that's in the carving pavilion, and what they're doing is they're researching on it. So not only have we just started planting stuff and have Lori and Ian been teaching us about the different plants and their uses, and trying some of them, eating some of them, putting some of them on our skin, and experimenting with them, figuring out what they are, they're going to research this. So we've already started that aspect. We're just on our research, and what they're going to do is organize their information into a quick access like blog page, and that quick access blog page will be able to look at the botanical description and its habitat, as well as picture of its description and what it looks like, so that people know that they have the right plant, and then being able to show the community who are engaging with our garden whether it's edible or not, so that if they know it's dangerous or not, whether what it's used for medicinally, how can they eat it, which parts can they eat, and then also the traditional uses that Indigenous peoples have used the plant for, and that is all intended to, and I didn't like bring it up on the screen, but so we made like a little template, so they would just like switch their picture here with a picture of their plant, And so it's all just organized in like a graphic organizer, pretty much, of how they can put their notes. And this is something that is on our share drive. So they don't even need like the paper copy, because we're trying to reduce paper, right? So they just go straight onto the share drive and they download it right onto their BSV account and they just start filling it in. And what we're hoping for is that these traditional uses, the little boxes for traditional uses, that it's just like a really quick summary and that there'll be a link to the further research. And so a lot of our students have difficulty with fine motor abilities, and a lot require being able to type and use tablets and use technology in order to communicate their ideas to us, to show us that they understand what we're asking them to be open to. And part of that is also written output, that they can make connections between how things have ended up now and how it got to be that way. And not only do Indigenous people have traditional practices with these plants or with their environment, but they have current practices that have been adapting over the years. Grass and cedar and different things, and how some of those things may have stayed the same over the years and some of them have changed, and we're but they came from and hopefully it would be like a one page kind of technology blog type of page that looks at the practices from the local First Nations here, but also to acknowledge that there are other First Nations in Canada that also use these same plants or similar plants, and what their words are for it, and maybe how they're similar or not. So we got really excited about planning this, and that it fits into the new curriculum is a bonus. As a professional, this is where we see our most pride in our students, is seeing them have an input into designing something and doing something that is actually going to be functional and authentic and used, and not just, you know, thrown in the recycling bin later. So it's a more valuable learning experience. I think that's it. Might have left something out, but I can't remember. But thank you for listening.
Wow, thank you. Thank you all so much. Having grown up and gone to school on traditional Coast Salish territory, learning about Indigenous food systems was very notably absent from my education, and so it really warms my heart to know that you're taking these radical acts. I love that term, and I'm so grateful for you sharing your knowledge with us. I want to pass over any questions to the audience for the listeners. So if you do have a question, please type it in the Q&A box, and you guys can take a look at that if anything pops up. In the meantime, while people are asking their questions, I have kind of a logistical question for you. If there was a champion from a school who really wanted to practice reconciliation through some sort of farm to school activities, through a food activity, what do you think would be the best first step if nothing is currently happening at that school to get started?
To their First Nations Enhancement Worker. Every school is attached to a First Nations Enhancement Worker, and that's exactly what their role is, contact with people that will help you either learn more about it yourself as a teacher in that community, or connecting you with a teacher in that community. So First Nations Enhancement workers' role in schools, and every school should have a First Nations enhancement worker, will connect teachers in learning about who they can access and putting them in contact with those people. And if it's someone in the community, they should be able to find a contact for the First Nations enhancement worker of that school, and they can start to have that conversation about how they can work together and what the goals are for that. And put them in contact with teachers who might be interested in working.
Thank you. Okay, there's a question from Kira.
No, there's no link already. We will be sharing with that. So part of, I guess that's the part I missed. So once they've done all this research and once we have it technologically, I guess, online, which will probably be accessible through the Grandview Woodland.
Yeah. So we are working on creating a website. And we haven't figured out exactly how the conversation between the website and the class and the students and where it will all come together, but that's the goal. One of the ideas is that in the garden, there'll be a QR code for the public. I don't understand all this technology myself, but the public can click on a code that's on signage in the garden and link up to this website. So it'll be a kind of a cool connection between the public and the students through this site.
That's great. I have just another question about resources, speaking of which, do you know of any other additional resources that you would recommend for teachers looking into this or parents looking into this?
I've already started accumulating like website links, and mm-hmm. that's something that through this project I'm hoping to make available too, is having a full Works Cited, like just from what the students have already done in Works Cited, we have probably about 10, 15 sources between books and websites. And I've already started accumulating some for them, because as we go through the research process, some are more easily navigatable than others. And for some students who have learning differences that make it hard for them to extract that kind of information, I've been really working one-on-one with those students and finding and looking at ways to take notes in a way that they can understand and how they can organize it so it's not too overwhelming later. So I've already started gathering these websites together. I haven't done anything with them specifically right now. Right now we're just focusing on research, but that's mm-hmm. something that we want to be able to make public, hopefully through this project, that there might be a link or something to a resource page, and we'll keep a list. We've been recording them as we go. As for, I think a lot of times that as teachers, we kind of get things word of mouth, and you know, Google is the great teacher in answering almost all of our questions, but it's overwhelming. So, if you're with the Vancouver School Board, so every school board should have some kind of district learning principal at their board level. There are always a great place to start in asking, do we have someone that has access or is organizing these resources? Who in the community has kind of already been approved by the school board to be able to come in and work with my class, or even just having guest speakers? I'm finding that it doesn't matter how many times I say it as a teacher to them, as soon as I invite someone in and they say it, it's all of a sudden makes more sense, and it's, oh yeah, now it's real. So it doesn't matter if it's something that you've already been teaching them, having someone in the community come in and discuss that, and like, you know, some kind of expert, even just, you know, saying, introducing them as this is an expert in their field, has a lot of validation for the students, and it just kind of breaks up that monotonous classroom time of sitting, listening, and then responding. And it's always nice to have other people come in to kind of validate what you've been saying as a teacher. Where else? Just looking at my notes to see if there's anything else of resources. Enhancement workers, again, they're probably the number one go-to person that you should go to first, is for specifically First Nation, integrated First Nations content. Otherwise, we're using First Voices. I can't remember if that's a .ca or a .com, but it's a Canadian database website, and it has all of the First Nations languages that have started to upload and collect data and put into an organized database for First Nations languages in Canada. So the students are using that to find the language words, to name the plants.
That's incredibly valuable. Thank you.
For resources, let me think. Where resources? Well, are you talking like books and stuff like that, or people? Like, can you define like how to get going? What garden what plants to put in?
I think any of the above. I think for teachers and for parents who are looking to integrate Indigenous food into their school system, how could they get started? You know, this watching this webinar has already been probably an amazing first step, and just, you know, where to go from here.
I like what Spirit was saying, you know, asking those support workers who mm-hmm. would come in and start to have a discussion. I think this webinar is going to be a really good resource for people to start to think a bigger picture here. You know, any of our Indigenous plant books that, you know, are in the marketplace, that we can start to, again, think about it. One of the things that I always like to share is when we're looking at a site, and this is what Ian and I did when he asked me to come in and look at the site, because here we are in a parking lot. I have to say, this is one of the best looking parking lots probably in the city, not just because of that carving pavilion and this beautiful garden that's going there, but there just happens to be a lot of trees in that parking lot. And to me, I think that's a great design, and which brings up the concept of permaculture, where we're, you know, starting, you know, walking around the school and start to get that feel and envision, wow, what would grow here? And if we go out in nature, so here's a good resource. If you go out in nature and you go for a walk in the woods and you come across berry bushes or, you know, various other plants that you're kind of interested, start looking how that plant is actually growing. So, you know, one of the challenges I said to Ian, I go, if we want to do huckleberries, we need to get some stumps into the garden. We've got to let them start to decay, and then we'll be able to get those huckleberries growing. So that's what we did. We brought some, you know, we're bringing in the concept of the forest into the parking lot. And, you know, I just chatted with a principal at an elementary school the other day, and she said, you know, we want to change the playground. You know, we want to bring in some stumps and rocks for the kids to grow. And I said, perfect. Then we can bring in some Indigenous plants to add into that scaping. So you can see this can be, you know, a new phase. And one of the words that I just wrote down as Spirit was talking, as she was describing, can't remember exactly what, but it's the word relevant. And this is what's exciting about this new curriculum, is that we can start to bring relevance into the classroom. That, you know, these kids, and that's only because I'm older, I can say kids, they're going to walk out and they're going to have something they're going to have for the rest of their life, right? Learning how to grow food, knowing their environment, knowing the native foods, and how we can incorporate them into our life. I think Ian wants to share some stuff
There was one resource that I was just thinking about, and some of you may know the resource that I'm talking about, but an organization over on Vancouver Island created a box of cards I don't know if it was through the health authority or who it was through, but this box of cards and they include the names of all the plants, the indigenous plants, the cultural uses, and all of the information and with a photo or with a drawing or a photo of the plants. And it looked like a fantastic resource to have on hand, like a deck of cards. So if anyone knows where you can find those, do you have some? Yeah, they're great. I've seen them, but I don't know where to get them from.
Okay, I'll see if maybe we can post that on our website if we're able to track that down, and we can list some of these resources as well.
Yeah, Stacy's maybe knows where you can get them.
Oh, Stacy, yeah. Great, thanks, Stacy. Okay, I am sad to say that our time is up with you fine folk. I really appreciate this discussion, and on behalf of all of us listening, I want to extend a deep thanks to our panelists here. So thanks for sharing your knowledge and stories. I'm just gonna end off by saying that, thanks from Farm to School. We won't be having a Farm to School webinar in December, but we will start again in January. So stay in touch and look on our website as to when that's gonna be happening. And if you'd like to get in touch with any of the panelists or with myself, just send us an email. My email is vancouverregion@farmtoschoolbc.ca. And you can learn more at farmtoschoolbc.ca. So don't hesitate to get in touch. And thank you again. Have a lovely day, everyone.
Thanks, you.
Sam.
Awesome. Thank you.
Bye.